That means demand will not change. Demand will not change irrespective of the price. Demand will not change. Then the seller is not interested on giving credit. Seller is interested on giving credit only if you purchase more, if he gives you credit. But if you are not going to purchase more, even if he gives you credit, it is better not to give credit only. True or false? True. Because you are going to buy only one piece. So you are going to buy that, whether I give you credit or not. But sometimes when you give credit, people buy more. So that is called inelastic product. Demand is not affected irrespective of price or credit period. Then you sell it on cash only. Don't give credit. If the product is perishable, credit period will be small, perishable product. But if you buy, suppose, a washing machine, then you can go for easy installment of 12 months. Is it right? But suppose you buy ice cream, he has given the ice cream to you, and then you say, "No, please give credit." Is it possible? You buy vegetable on credit or cash? Cash, ask 3 months credit. Quantum of sale. Quantum of sale. If you buy one notebook, two notebooks, they will not give you credit. But if you buy 1,000 notebooks, they might give you credit. Then customs and practices also. So in some business, there is no credit period policy. So they will ask you to pay immediately. In some business, there is a credit period. So then you have to offer credit period. Right? Like when we sell audit books, accounting standard book to our booksellers, there is a system of giving credit. They are not going to make the payment. They will say, "Please sell in this attempt, we'll pay you in the next attempt." That is the policy. So there is no choice. Everybody does that. Otherwise, he will not purchase. But with respect to student, it is not attempt to attempt. It is in advance only. So that is called custom and practice. Same entity, AS Foundation, is selling a pen drive to a student and selling books to book vendor. But when the student wants a pen drive, video lecture on pen drive, we have to ask him to pay immediately. But when a book vendor wants, say, 200 books, we say you pay afterwards. Funds available with the company also. So cash-rich company can give credit. A company which already have shortage of money will have lower credit period. Okay. And then one more factor which affects your credit period is what is the possibility of bad debt. If the possibility of bad debt is high, no credit or low credit period, okay. But if the possibility of bad debt is very low, then you can extend the credit period. Next paragraph. How are credit period expressed? Credit period is generally stated in terms of net days. For example, if credit terms are net 45, it means the customer will have to make payment before, on or before 45 days. So 45 days means he has to make payment on or before 45 days. Now we'll also discuss discount policy. What is discount policy here? Should we offer discount? Point number one. And point number two, what should be the discount rate to be offered? Does discount policy help the enterprise in early collection? Yes. Because the customer, in order to obtain that cash discount, will come and make the early payment. So the benefit is that your collection becomes fast, bad debt is reduced, collection cost is reduced, legal cost is reduced. But there is a cost. The cost is the discount only. If you give 50,000 discount and save 30,000 rupees in collection cost and bad debt, is it justified to give discount? Discount given 50,000. Bad debt saved 30,000. No, let the bad debt be 30,000. Because to save 30, I will not spend 50,000 on that. So what do you mean by discount policy? Discount policy relates to percentage of cash discount to be offered to incentivize the customer to make early payment. Okay, this is carrot. Give him carrot. Make early payment, get discount. Is it right? And in order to get the discount, the customer will try to make early payment. Second is period within which cash discount can be availed. So see, understand this point. Now here they will say, if you pay on time, we'll give you 2% discount. So this 2% is your rate. But then they will also put a time limit also. If you pay in 0 to 5 days only, then we'll give you 2% cash discount. Okay? But if you pay after 5 days, 5 to 10 days, we'll give 1% discount. If you pay after 10 days, no discount. So that is also the limit that you have to give to the customer. So in order to make early payment, if he pays in 5 days, he will get 2%. So he will try his best to make payment in 5 days. And if he misses that deadline, he will try to pay in 10 days. At least 1% benefit he will get. In some business, the margins are very low. Yes or no? So even if you get 2% cash discount, that itself is your profit in that particular business. Point number next. Discounts are given to speed up collection of debts. True or false? Was it taught in your accounts classes also, cash discount? Difference between trade discount and cash discount. What is difference between trade and cash discount? Trade discount is given to promote sales, to increase the quantum of sale. But cash discount is given to, for early payment, prompt payment, to motivate the customer to make early payment. Is it right? If he makes early payment, he will get cash discount. If he does not make early payment, he will lose the discount. So it improves the liquidity of the seller. Benefit of cash discount. You will get cash flow earlier. Because there is an incentive to make early payment. It also ensures prompt collection. And the advantage of cash discount policy that it reduces your risk of bad debt significantly, because customer on his own will try to come and make the payment and avail the cash discount. So that is the advantage of cash discount. But what is the cost? The amount of discount given itself is the cost. Now I am going to teach you something interesting. How are cash discount policy explained to the customer? Credit terms are explained like this: rate of cash discount, cash discount period, and net credit period. Now in some exam question, they have asked like this: credit terms are 2 by 10 net 60. Credit terms are 2 by 10 net 60. Now how do you interpret this line? Year, date 0, date 10, date 60. So what the supplier is telling the customer: dear customer, if you pay between 0 to 10 days, you will get 2% cash discount. If you pay within 0 to 10 days, you will get 2% cash discount. But if you pay after 10th day, no discount. At the same time, you please ensure that you pay the amount in 60 days. So if the bill is of 100 rupees, if he pays any time between 0 to 10 days, he will have to pay only 98. But if he pays after 10th day, then he will have to pay 100 rupees. But then they have also put an upper limit on the credit period. In any case, you have to pay in 60 days. Okay. So underline, it means that a cash discount of 2% will be granted if the customer pays within 10 days. If he does not avail the offer, he must pay within 60 days, being the normal credit period. Okay. So now tell me, what do you mean by 3 by 15 net 90? So if you pay within 15 days, 3% cash discount will be given to you. But if you don't want to avail the offer, then you must pay in 90 days. You must pay in 90 days. So if you pay here any time between 0 to 15 days, you will have to pay only 97% of the invoice amount. But if you pay here, you will have to pay 100% of the amount. Is it right? But in any case, you can't delay beyond 90 days. Some companies put an interest clause also. If you pay after 90 days, then interest at the rate of 24% per annum would be charged. It is written in many invoices also below, if you have seen. If you delay, interest will be charged. If you pay early, you get discount. If you delay, you pay the interest. Okay, so again, depends on your question. Oh, problem. So first we'll solve few questions on credit policy and discount policy. Okay. Whatever formula you have learnt in costing and in FM and in accounts also, for example, they will be useful today. For example, all of you know the formula of contribution. What is contribution? Sales minus variable cost. That's good. So first write down in the notebook chapter's name. What is the chapter going on? Capital budgeting. Then management of accounts receivable. Right, management of accounts receivable. Then write down some important formulae. Some important. And this also you add in the list of formulae, but it is already there in one or the other chapters. Nothing new. Some important formulae related to debtors, related to sales, etc. So first formula you write. Contribution. Whatever I remember immediately, I will dictate. Contribution is equal to sales minus variable cost. So variable cost means sales minus fixed cost, nalak. Sales minus contribution. Can I write these two like this? No. If sale minus contribution is variable cost, sale minus variable cost is contribution. Is it true or false? Jallor, is it true or false? True. Next. Profit volume ratio. This is contribution called PV ratio. Is contribution upon sales. Do you remember? Contribution upon sales into 100. Contribution upon sales into 100. Point 4. Gross profit ratio. Gross profit ratio is equal to gross profit upon sales into 100. Is it right? 5, cost of goods sold, sales minus gross profit. Sales minus gross profit, or you can also say gross profit equal to sales minus cost of goods sold. Depending upon how the data is given, you have to move from gross profit to COGS or COGS to gross profit. Point number 7, total cost is equal to variable cost plus fixed cost. Variable cost plus fixed cost. Do you agree? Then 8, write down, profit is equal to sales minus total cost. Sales minus total cost. Basic formula, but I will summarize at one place. Okay, common sense is not so common nowadays. You will see today only, in next few minutes. People make mistake in this also. We are so intelligent, we will make mistake even if there is no possibility. Okay. Now next formula, which are very important, these are basic, already discussed in 11th, 12th classes only. Investment in receivable. Investment in receivable. Now they will ask you to calculate opportunity cost of investment in receivable. But then I need to first find out what is investment in receivable. It means average debtor balance. It means average debtors balance. It means average debtor balance. Formula was already given to you in two chapters before this. One is ratio analysis and one is management of working capital. Is it right? Now here we will have three formulas. A, based on credit sales. Based on credit sale. So the formula is credit period or average collection period, whatever terminology they use. In some problem they will say credit period is 3 months, in some problem they will say average collection period is 3 months, it's same thing. Divide by 12 months or 365 days, depending upon whether you are given credit period in months or into credit sales. Is it a new formula or old formula? Old formula. Okay, it is simply proportionate amount. You don't have to remember also. If credit sale is 10 lakh and credit period is 3 months, so 3 by 12 into 10 lakh, 2,50,000 is your average debtors balance, is your average funds blocked in debtors. Point B, write down, based on total cost. Based on total cost. Based on total cost. Now you write the formula, same formula. Only change the last thing. Credit period divided by 12 or 365 into total cost. Sometime in some questions sales figure may not be there. Then we have to use cost and see based on variable cost. Based on variable cost. So the formula will now be credit period divided by 12 months or 365 days 365 days into variable cost. Variable cost means only variable cost of sale. It will not include fixed cost. Now there are three approaches of calculating the funds blocked in receivable: sales, total cost, variable cost approach. Which one you will use to solve the problem? Now we don't have so much time to solve in three ways, okay? Although in some chapters I said use two approaches, total approach, cash approach. Here also ideally I should say the same. Use sales approach, use cost approach, use variable cost approach. But because we have limited time, and suppose you have enough data available to apply either of the three approaches, this I will give the first priority. Priority number one, total cost approach. I'll tell you why. First, right. Priority number two, variable cost approach. If you can't apply total cost approach, then apply variable cost approach. Reason, fixed cost may not be given to you in the problem. If the fixed cost is not given to you in the problem, you can't calculate total cost. Then whatever is the variable cost, that we will use. Third priority, third priority. Now let us see the logic of using total cost of goods sold in calculating the amount blocked in debtors. A businessman will think like this, that I have to sell this pen on credit. Okay, assume this pen I have to sell on credit. Its variable cost is 20 rupees, fixed cost is say 30 rupees, so the total cost is 50 rupees. Total cost, selling price is 100 rupees. In order to manufacture and sell this pen, how much funds will I require? Will I require 100 rupees or 50 rupees? Will I require 100 rupees or 50 rupees? So I can borrow from the bank 50 rupees, manufacture the pen and sell it. So bank will charge me interest on 50 rupees only. So my funds actually blocked, my actual funds blocked in debtor is total cost. 50 is the profit margin over and above my cost. But this 50 rupees I could have used elsewhere and I would have earned interest. So therefore total cost approach will be preferred, because that represents my actual funds that is blocked in manufacturing the goods. Sometimes fixed cost is not available, then I can use variable cost for exam purpose. But if both fixed and variable are available, then I will use total cost. Of course, institute will get the priority. Who will get the priority? If they are saying use variable cost approach, do I have a choice? They are saying use credit sales to estimate debtor, then I have to use credit sales to estimate debtors. In the ratio analysis chapter, we have used credit sales to estimate the debtors balance. More than 50-55 questions we solved where we had computed debtors in ratio chapter and we have found out receivable balance. And that time we had used which figure? Credit sales figure. But today, because it's a special topic, I need to be more accurate. I need to check how much funds do I actually need to make the sale. The funds that I actually need to make the sale is the total cost of goods sold rather than the sale value. With 50 rupees also I can make the credit sale. Am I right? If I have 50 rupees, I can produce a good and I can sell it. So my funds blocked is 50 rupees. For my management analysis purpose, I will not tell the customer what is my cost, but for my own understanding that I have put 50 rupees to generate this sale. Right? Even in your institutes, material and past examination answer. That is the priority they have given. Total cost, first priority. Variable cost, second priority. Credit sale, third priority. Unless any specific request is made by the institute, we'll follow this. Okay. This you have noted. Okay. Now the next formula. How many we have written? 9. 10 write down. Debtors turnover ratio. This I forgot actually. Debtors turnover ratio. Debtors turnover ratio. Do you remember? Debtors turnover ratio. Credit sales upon average debtors. Oh. Now you remember. Debtor collection period. Just some days before only we have done this. Debtors collection period, we have used this formula in operating cycle. Yes. There are two formula. One is average debtor upon average credit sales per day or month. Okay. If you write per day, you'll get answer in days. If you write per month, you'll get answer in month. Or 365 or 12 divided by debtors turnover ratio. 365. If you take 365, you'll get answer in days. If you take 12, you'll get answer in months. So in some question, we have to find debtors collection period from debtors turnover ratio. Okay. They can use any other word, receivable turnover ratio, account receivable turnover ratio, all are same. Any query? And then in some question, we will have to compute bad debts also. So bad debt equal to credit sales into bad debt percentage. Into bad debt percentage. Credit sales into bad debt percentage. So they will say a customer wants to buy from you. There is a 5% risk of non-payment. Means 5% into credit sale. That will be your bad debt amount. That amount you will not be able to collect from him. Keep some more 10 lines blank in case if you come across some new formula, you can just put it below that. Okay. So that all formula relating to debtors will be at one place. And this you should make a list in your proper notebook where all formulas will be there at one place. There's no harm in remembering formula, but you have to understand what purpose do they serve. When to use them. Okay. Question number 1. A firm's product sales for rupees 10 a unit. A firm's product sales for rupees 10 a unit means selling price is 10 rupees. Out of which 7 represents variable cost before tax including credit department cost. Can you reach this question? So 7 rupees is the variable cost. Current annual sales are rupees 12 lakh. Current annual sales are how much? Rupees 12 lakh. Represented entirely by credit sales. So this firm only sells on credit. What is your existing sales amount in rupees? 12 lakh. And selling price is 10 rupees. Can you guess sales quantity? Sales quantity 1,20,000 unit. Very good. And the average total cost per unit is 9 rupees before tax. So this time your intelligence will be tested. variable cost is 7.